I would like the members of the panel to please take their seats on the stage. Martin Indyk, Itamar Rabinovich, Sallai Meridor. I would like to remind you that there is a fifth ambassador here who will not be speaking, Zalman Shoval. We have five ambassadors to Washington, from Washington. Now is only number two in Washington. Number two in the EU, but number two in Washington. Number one in Europe. In Jordan, sorry. Excuse me. You already understood from how I am presenting this panel that I again will tell you to take out your leaf, your booklet, and you'll see the bios of the people on the stage. There is one question, like we did in previous sessions, that you will be requested to answer by text message. This is the question. You see it up on the screen. Forget what I said at the beginning. And please express your opinion. And the results will be given at the end of the session. The first question, which I would like to ask the panel members, is: the Prime Minister has explained why it is his duty to appear before both Congress and the Senate and to explain the severity of the danger of the deal with Iran. The current ambassador to Washington has said, as the media said, that the benefit of the Israeli Prime Minister's appearance in the Congress is more than the damage to their relationship with the President. What is wrong about this logic? Martin Indyk, please.
First of all, I want to congratulate Ambassador Shapiro. Having been in his position, I deeply admire the effectiveness of his presentation.
We all share it.
And it sets it a very important context for what we're going to discuss now, because it underscores the deep and broad and, I would say, profound ties between the United States and Israel. And the President, President Obama, Secretary Kerry, keep on saying those ties are unshakable. And that is true, and we should all bear it in mind, especially when we have a desire to hyperventilate about the current crisis in US-Israel relations. Having said that, we are in a crisis. And it's particularly troubling for me, as somebody who's spent my entire 35-year career committed to the US-Israel relationship, from the first time I was exposed to its importance in the Yom Kippur War here in Jerusalem in 1973. And why it has always been the kind of guiding focus of my career is because the United States-Israel relationship is Israel's second line of defense. It is Israel's force multiplier. It is the thing that gives Israel its greatest deterrent capability. And so the people who are celebrating today are not Americans or Israelis. They are Israel's enemies because they love to see a split between the United States and Israel. And so it's a real problem. And there are people in Israel these days, it seems, that seem to find some pleasure in this crisis And I do not understand their logic. I simply don't understand it. I think it's dangerous for Israel. And I would say dangerous for the United States as well and our interest in the region. There's a long way of answering your question. On the particular question, I've never seen so much expected of a speech. And I think one has to think about what exactly is going to be achieved by this speech. Is it really going to turn around the minds of the President of the United States and his negotiators, that they'll suddenly wake up and say, oh, we're negotiating a very bad deal here, and silly us, we'll change our minds? Or will it convince a veto-proof majority of the Senate that they should act in a way to sink the deal? Maybe it could have done that in a circumstance in which it was done in a way to build bipartisan support for a common position in Israel, which is a real concern, an understandable concern about what this deal is going to look like. But the Republicans don't have 60 votes in the Senate. They don't have the votes without the Democrats to do anything. And without those votes, the speech is not going to be able to achieve anything. And to make it into a partisan issue, which is the way that it was handled, to work with the Republican speaker behind the back of the President of the United States, is to put the Democrats who might otherwise cheer the Prime Minister on the substance of the matter, put them in an impossible situation where they have to choose between the Prime Minister of Israel and the President of the United States. And that's an untenable position. That's why they are protesting loudly. That's why leaders of the Jewish community are feeling very uncomfortable. Let's not forget that 75 to 80% of the American Jewish community are Democrats. And I'll leave the other ambassadors here to relate to this point, but Israel has always been a bipartisan issue in the United States. There has always been strong bipartisan support for Israel. To turn this into a partisan issue is to strike a blow to the foundations of the U.S.-Israel relationship that is, I think, far more problematic than the advantages of giving a speech against a potential nuclear deal.
Thank you, Martin. Itamar, we are where we are, 2 weeks before the speech. Now the question, is there a way out of the crisis as Martin described? If you are the ambassador in Washington, what do you suggest to the Israeli Prime Minister? How do we get out of it?
Let me put two facts for context. One is, I think that the crucial date is not the date of the speech, but the date of the Israeli election. I think we are in the midst of a crisis. It's reparable. It depends on the outcome of the Israeli elections, because if the Israeli elections produce a government that would wish and act to resume a negotiating process with the Palestinians and build or rebuild a relationship of trust with the president, this could be water under the bridge. We are dealing here with seasoned, pragmatic political figures. Brain rather than emotions could carry the day, and therefore, as far as I'm concerned, the date of the election and the coming days of post-election bargaining are going to determine the shape of the Israeli government and therefore the nature of the American-Israeli relationship. Secondly, I think there's more to the crisis than just the bad relationship between two individuals. There's been a very important change in 2009. To put it somewhat simplistically, America went left and Israel went right. So President Obama and his wing of the party represent something different, both with regard to the Clinton administration and certainly to the Bush administration. The Middle East policy is articulated during Obama's campaign and in the first few months of his presidency, the Cairo speech and so forth, represented a change in policy. At the very same time, Israel went to the right. Let's remember that in 2006, Israel chose a prime minister, Ehud Olmert, who wanted to continue Sharon's policy in Gaza in the West Bank. That was just 3 years before 2009, and then in 2009, Israel ended up with a right-wing government. And much of the acrimony is the result of genuine policy differences between two individuals. I think both learned something along the way, and President Obama today, I think, looks at the Middle East differently than he did in 2006. But, of course, you have structural elements in their relationship, but they always end up through a personal prism of the two principals, the president and the prime minister. That's, of course, a difficult issue. So, you know, I could give the prime minister a gratuitous, superfluous advice about not doing the speech in Congress, giving the speech at AIPAC, meeting with congressmen and senators separately. There are many ways of trying to affect the outcome. As you said, there is the agreement itself, which you know, is not perfect, but it is what it is, and there are other ways of improving it rather than an open public confrontation with the president. And you know, we've had earlier instances in the last 20 years where the government of Israel or its friends in the United States took on a U.S. president on Capitol Hill. And my maxim was, never take on the president on Capitol Hill. You do not want to win and you do not want to lose. Because if you win, you have wounded the president. If you lost, your bluff has been called. So that's not something any Israeli prime minister or government should do. So there are other ways of doing that. But my advice, I think the prime minister yesterday was very explicit about his determination to go. The ambassador was very explicit about his defense of the policy. I'd be very surprised if there is a change in that regard, but I'm trying to look further to March 17 and beyond.
Thank you, Itamar. Sallai, you've been not only the ambassador of Israel in Washington, you've been also the chairman of the Jewish Agency. And Martin reminded us of the fact that 75% of the Jewish community in the United States is voting Democratic for the Democrat leaders and Democratic candidates in presidential elections. Is there a danger, not only because of the row now about the speech, but in terms of the overall relations between Israel and the Jewish community, given several problems, not only political, but the whole Jewish issues, conversion, etc.?
Okay, first of all, the Jewish community in the United States naturally feels better when there are no disagreements between the U.S. government and the Israeli government. And their well-being and their strength and their relationship with us is a factor, should be a factor in our policymaking, but not the only factor. And sometimes, if you are convinced, or one is convinced, that pursuing Israeli interests and the Jewish people's interests at large demand some level of disagreement and discomfort for some American Jews, it may be the case that Israel will choose a path that is not comfortable at the moment for American Jews. My concern here is that this is not the situation. Going back to your first question, it's not a lose-win situation. that you win on this, you lose on that, and then you measure whether you lose more or win more. It's a lose-lose-lose situation. You cannot advance any interest of Israel without cooperation from the U.S. president. Bipartisan support for Israel is not just an emotional thing. It's critical for our security, for our well-being. And no one's happier than the Iranians when they see this theater. So I cannot see what calculus of cost-benefit could have led to a lose-lose-lose outcome. And this is, to me, worrisome.
So what would you say now to the Prime Minister? Look, this is a damage, serious deep damage. How do we get out of it?
Look, he is now, unfortunately, we are now up the ladder on the tree, but not alone. We are there with many Republican friends. And going down the ladder is not that simple. But if I were him and I'm not him, I would advise my ambassador to make every effort possible to find a way down the ladder in a bipartisan manner. I don't know whether it's feasible, climbing up a ladder with one party, going down with two. But that would be, to me, the desired outcome on this very issue.
Ambassador Shapiro just said a few minutes ago that the United States will work with any government we choose on the 17th of March. Now, which brings me to the issue of Iran. Obviously, in terms of the panel and can we foresee a situation where the two governments, especially if it's a center-right government, work together, the two governments, on the issue of Iran, and what can be done between the two governments on this issue before, maybe too late, but after the, or within the reaching of the agreement? What can be done in order to close the gap between the positions of the Israeli, at least the current government, and the administration on the issue of Iran? Itamar?
I think actually that in an earlier panel today here, Dennis Ross made a very, right. Very insightful and potentially very promising. He raised a very promising idea that if Congress legislates sort of almost automatic sanctions in the event of an Iranian infringement in the future, that could be very, very useful in itself and play a very important role in allaying one of the significant fears of the Israelis and of the Saudis and of others that the issue is not so much the 1 year distance from the breakaway, but the concern that over time Americans, Europeans and so forth may lose some of their attention and dedication to the issue, and that the Iranians who are very determined to move on will creep towards the bomb. So working with Congress and with the administration in a way that would enable Congress to play a certain role, there may not be enough time and there may not be enough goodwill and all the other requirements that are necessary for such a move. But in the next few weeks, bringing Congress in the capacity that I mentioned could actually be good in itself and also a way of trying to mend some of the problems that have been mentioned.
Martin, do you think that President Obama could go along with this proposition, that is to say legislation, not just a sense of Congress, but legislation, which he has to sign in order to make it into a bill? Can the president go along with this idea?
I think there are several complications involved. The idea that Dennis Ross suggested this morning, which I think is creative, of in effect having a kind of automaticity to the response so as to build up the deterrence against Iran's violation of any commitment. That, if it involves use of force, is something I think any president would be reluctant to do, and I suspect the Congress would also be reluctant to legislate for that. Why? Because it puts Iran's finger on the American trigger. And so it's not that the United States wouldn't in some circumstances be willing to use force, but to have it automatically done in that way is something that I think the president would have a problem with. I suspect the Congress would too. There's one issue here which needs clarification, and I can't clarify it because I don't know enough about the negotiations. But my guess is that the sanctions will not be lifted as part of this deal. They will be suspended. I don't think that the president has any way that he can get the Congress to lift the sanctions. In other words, do away with them. And so, if I'm right, that they're simply suspended, they can be reimposed. Now, it would be very difficult to get everybody on board around the international community, but the really important sanctions, the financial sanctions, are American sanctions. And
there are some tough European ones.
Yes. To be sure. No. I was saying, we can't legislate for Europe, so that's not part of the discussion. But the third thing I would say is that, and it's something that I've felt for a very long time is important, is that in the context of a deal in which, regardless of the specific details, there is a fundamental difference between the United States and Israel. Because the United States, and we heard it from Cooper Vassar this morning, can afford to have Iran as a near-threshold nuclear power. And Israel is saying it can't. And that's related to the very different security circumstances of the United States and Israel. And so instead of kind of having an argument about that, we should concede it. And the United States should enter immediately into discussions with Israel about a nuclear guarantee for Israel. Those discussions have already been undertaken at Camp David during the negotiations between Yasser Arafat and Ehud Barak, in which Barak came to Clinton and asked him, in the context of an agreement with the Palestinians, for a nuclear guarantee. And it was approved then, and the United States and the president said to the Prime Minister of Israel, if there's a deal, we'll do this. Well, it's going to be a different kind of deal, but it may go a considerable distance towards calming Israeli concerns about the consequences of an Iranian reneging on the commitments that it makes in this deal.
The problem, among other things, is that you still need legislation, because presidential guarantees, with all due respect, I mean, not facetious, they are promises.
Correct. This would be a treaty commitment.
Okay.
And it would require legislation, and I believe it would pass pretty much unanimously.
I'm glad Martin mentioned the word treaty because, as Martin said, in 2000 a guarantee was discussed. In 96 a treaty was discussed when Shimon Peres was prime minister, and the issue of an Israeli-Syrian deal was seriously on the table. The idea of asking the United States to sign a defense treaty with Israel as part of underwriting the deal with Syria was discussed or raised again in the among the Israeli decision makers and analysts and so forth. And the Israeli outlook on this is not that clear because a treaty cuts both ways. I mean, you do want the American underwriting, but the Americans would then want consultation, which would mean that Israel's freedom of action would be limited. You cannot ask for an automatic American guarantee and then act on your own. So that's a whole discussion that obviously will not be sorted out between today and the speech or today and March 17, but I think since Iran and the Iranian issue is not going to go away and the Palestinian issue is going to remain on the table, these issues will be discussed in years to come. It's also, Martin again mentioned the need to have a congressional decision, so what referring to what Sallai said, that in order to help, if you want to climb down the ladder without offending the Republicans in Congress, that could be a way of giving them a role in what would be sort of the grand exit from the current crisis.
Sallai, in your assessment, the current Israeli government, and if the current Israeli government continues after the 17th of March, more or less the same composition, will the Israeli prime minister government follow this sort of plan or an idea?
Well, I don't know.
Because the agreement doesn't change. What changes is the additional part concerning the U.S. guarantee. The agreement stays as it is, or as it will be. 6,000 plus centrifuges, etc., etc.
Let me start from the beginning, if I may. We assume here that there is an agreement, which is still a question mark. We assume that the agreement is perceived as a bad agreement by the leadership of Israel. Given that these are the circumstances, I think it's a very, very serious situation for Israel. As much as I said, I disagreed, hopefully respectfully, with our Prime Minister on the how, I very much agree with him on the what. And I think that should the U.S. accept an agreement within the parameters that have been leaked, it puts Israel in a very, very serious situation. And they wouldn't take it lightly. Directly from Iran, with what Iran can influence, and with what may come in the region by proliferation with other countries, where the Iranian deal would become the model for every other country capable of doing that to become practically a nuclear threshold state. So, first of all, I would look at it very seriously. Secondly, I would think that it is right for Israel under such circumstances to maintain its independence in doing different things. I cannot testify now to what our capabilities are, but whatever they are, we should keep our independence in pursuing our capabilities in defense of our interests. If I were the ambassador, I would not, under those circumstances, recommend to the Prime Minister, go ask for compensation. If I were an advisor to an American government, and if I were not an Israeli, I would say that they should look for ways. One area would be how America, if possible at all, assures its allies of what it would do in case of violation on the part of the Iranians. And the other area would have to be with deterrence, but I would look more into areas of increasing Israel's deterrence posture rather than supplying Israel with an American umbrella. But at any rate, I would not trade Israeli ability to act with any kind of assurances.
Interesting point. In the time that we are left with, I would like to move to another issue in contention between the two states, between the two governments, and that is the Palestinian-Israeli negotiations. And my question is the following, very quickly. Given the regional circumstances, given the attitudes of at least this Israeli government and the Palestinian government, which chose the strategy of going to the international community, etc., etc., is it thinkable to resume negotiations? Is it feasible or doable to resume negotiations on the paradigm, Martin, that you based the negotiations in which you were involved, that is to say, a comprehensive peace dealing with all the core issues, or would it be better to resume but on a different paradigm, a partial, incremental, leading to the two-state solution?
It's a complicated question, and it's difficult to give you a short answer. Number one, I don't believe there is a possibility for an interim deal, at least with this Palestinian leadership. Number two, one of the problems with the negotiations that I had responsibility for on the American side last year was that there were no agreed terms of reference. We had no terms of reference other than 242, which doesn't deal with the Palestinian issue except in terms of, you know, the inadmissibility of acquisition of territory by force. So I do think that issue of terms of reference has to be addressed if there's to be a successful final status negotiation. Number three, and this is referred to by Israelis across the spectrum, there has to be some regional arrangement. You know, it's kind of like, where have you been for so long? But better late than never. The Palestinians are fundamentally weak, and they cannot make a deal without Arab support and Arab cover. The fact that you have President Sisi now saying something which he has not withdrawn from, that Egyptian troops could play a role in the security arrangements, is completely new and very interesting. And it would give cover to the Jordanians to play a similar role. But there's no doubt that the Egyptians and the Jordanians are critical players in terms of providing an Arab anchor for the Palestinians. And the Arab Peace Initiative provides a way in which to bring in the Saudis and the Gulf Arabs. So I think there has to be some combination of those factors. But none of it is going to be any use unless there is much greater trust between the leaders on both sides and an understanding on the part of the people on both sides that they do have a partner in the other side and they do need to try to resolve this and support their leaders in terms of the kind of very difficult compromises that both sides are going to have to make.
Sallai?
I agree with Martin that the question of whether the Arabs, and when we say the Arabs, I mean Egypt, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, and everybody else, but if you have these three you can assume that you will have most that you care for, whether they are in a position to make a contribution. I think that the lesson from the genuine attempts over the last probably 20, 30 years now to reach an agreement between us and the Palestinians is that there may not be enough between us and them, almost objectively, to bring about an agreement. And you need contribution from a third party that would bring assets to the table, that would be important for both the Palestinians and Israel to close the equation. And if we're talking a significant deal, and action should be taken even if there is no chance for significant deal. But if we are talking about an attempt to reach a significant agreement, I think that the...
What is a significant... What is an insignificant agreement?
Maybe the word significant was not the right choice, but a comprehensive agreement that would bring a peace treaty at the end of it. Normalization of relations and the like. I think that the critical necessary condition is to test whether there is willingness on the part of those key Arab states to participate and contribute, and how the events in the region, which occupy them immensely, impact positively or negatively on their willingness to do that. Short of that, I think effort should be made. I think that leaving that undealt with is too dangerous for all. In order to prevent deterioration and move things, hopefully, forward gradually by changes to the ground, by building all kinds of things, by transferring authority, by creating a horizon, all kinds of elements that need to be put in place, but realistically designed, marrying a real assessment of the assets you have with your wishes.
Thanks, Sallai. Itamar, this original framework is really important to reaching some sort of a deal with the Palestinians, given the state of
Regional framework is very important. Part of it has been explained by Martin. It's easier for a Palestinian leader to make concessions or apparent concessions with Arab consensus. Part of the reasons that Camp David 2000 failed was that Arab endorsement, support, or even pressure on Arafat was not available in 2000. I think this could change now. From an Israeli point of view, there's always a preference for dealing with Arab states than with the Palestinian non-state actor. There's a sense that with the Palestinians we have, in a way, a zero-sum game conflict. With the Arab states, we don't. They are states, they are orderly, they have state interests. So that is a major, both substantive and reassuring element from the Israeli point of view. But, you know, it's also become sort of a panacea today. Lots of Israelis say, a regional agreement, you know, would be a major step forward. Yes, I agree with that, but, you know, it won't come without a price tag. The Saudis or the Egyptians or the Jordanians will not move without being reassured that Israel means serious business on the Palestinian issue. Now, a second element that I should add. If you look at the Arab, Saudi Arab peace initiatives of 2002 and 2007, they speak about their return to the boundaries of 1967. That means also in the Golan Heights. Right now, it's a non-issue. No Israeli government in its right mind will think about or speak about a deal with non-existent Syria. So it could be actually an alleviating element in the picture to say that we are now talking about the Palestinian issue, that the Syrian dimension is neutralized, going to make the life of the Israeli party much easier.
Can I...
We have
30 seconds. I have a story to tell. Will you allow me?
I am not in control of the time. Go ahead. 25 seconds.
Boss says, huh? Okay. A story from the front, just to illustrate the difficulties involved in what we've been discussing here. As you probably know, Prime Minister Netanyahu insisted that as part of the deal, there would have to be Palestinian recognition of the
Jewish
state.
Yeah.
And President Obama, who's not very popular in this country, happens to believe that Prime Minister Netanyahu is right on this subject. And it is a matter of U.S. policy that Israel is the Jewish state. And so, therefore, Secretary Kerry and I took on the challenge of getting the Palestinians to agree to this. And we thought, following Itamar's principles, that the best thing to do was to convince the Arabs of this and have them support it, give cover to the Palestinians so that they could agree to it. And so we spent an inordinate amount of time. Secretary Kerry, I think, had six meetings. Of course, it was in Paris, so it wasn't that bad, but six meetings with the Arab follow-up committee, the seven Arab foreign ministers, the Saudis, the Emiratis, the Egyptians. I mean, everybody was there, the Jordanians, they're all there. And he made the case to them. And he did more. He went to the capitals. He talked to King Abdullah of Jordan, and he talked to King Abdullah of Saudi Arabia.
Who died just because of the question.
of blessed memory. And they all said, fine, it's time we get past this. We don't have a problem with it. And so we went to Abu Mazen and we said, we lined up the Arabs for you. You can do it. He didn't respond. He went to Cairo to a meeting of the Arab League foreign ministers, introduced a resolution which rejected any possibility of recognition of Israel as a Jewish state.
And it passed.
And they all voted for it.
Passed unanimously.
And when we called them up and said, whiskey tango foxtrot, I don't know whether you can translate that, they said, don't worry about it. It's not serious. It's just a resolution.
Should the President of the United States raise the issue of the Palestinian, yes or no, after the establishment of a new government? Yes or no? Should President Obama raise the Palestinian issue with the new Israeli government? Yes or no?
I think the Prime Minister of Israel should raise it.
Good. Martin?
Itamar is 100% right. It's the Prime Minister of Israel, whether it's whoever it is, needs to come to Washington immediately and recruit the American president to a serious, substantive, viable initiative, and an Israeli initiative, which the United States can get behind.
Sallai?
It's up to the Israeli prime minister, and I think he should. I think it's not only in what he would say. I think that the composition of the government will speak louder than statements to be made, and the policies of the government would speak even more loudly. And the government should adopt a policy voluntarily of, on the one hand, approaching towards the Arab world and the Palestinians, and at the same time offering major restraint on settlement building as an Israeli interest rather than being imposed on Israel by others.
Thank you, panel. Now we are going to watch the results of the audience verdict on the state of the relations between the United States and Israel. 61% saying, yes, we are watching a deterioration. Only 40% say, no, the relations are fine. So there you go. Thank you.